welcome to this session, Driving Up Quality in Care and Support. Quality, being the operative word. Quality in Care and Support, the work of the National Market Development Forum, which I've been a member because I'm on the National Co-Trust Advice Group and was a past chair, co-chair of TLAP. I'm Bill Davidson, by the way. I've got to introduce myself. Bill Davidson. I have been attached to TLAP since its beginnings, and even before that with the co-production setting. And for 14 years I've been involved in health and social care. Very interested in it. My history is, you might have seen when you read the biography, as 25 years a headmaster. So I shall expect you to sit up straight and pay attention. And I have a reputation, don't you? And I have a reputation of keeping to time for some reason. But 25 years as a head was probably, I was appointed when I was 27, so I could retire early. 25 years was probably 3 years too long, because I could take early retirement, have an association retirement, a modest pension, and admission to a psychiatric unit. Unfortunately. Well, that's how I got into the world of health and social care. And at the time in the 90s, quality, people tried very hard, but you had to fit into a system, I'm afraid. It's far away from being personalised. Nothing was on it. I'm not sure they understood the word personalised. Maybe one or two people did. But it was not of quality. Once I'd started to recover, and here I am, recovered, sort of. After 2 years, sort of having pub lunches, and a cardiac coach in the garden, whatever, but I can't do this for the rest of my life. So I got involved locally at first in health, trying not just to make it better for the patient, but more satisfying for the workforce. So when you've got a workforce that's allowed to be creative, flexible, etc., you're likely to have better job satisfaction, which reflects on the patient. That's a dual thing. And that's how I got involved 40 years ago in the world of health and social care. And very rapidly was attached with the Department of Health, King's College in research, and many other programmes, etc. I note there is something here, driving quality in adult social care house. It's interesting, I'm in a football stadium again. 2 weeks ago I was at the Reebok Stadium as a guest speaker talking about patient perspective on the Francis Report, and speaking, funny enough, to East Lancs next month about the same thing. And it's perfectly obvious as I look at that, that a lot of what happened, what didn't happen in South Staffs was a result of false assumptions about quality. Some people might have assumed there was quality there, but there wasn't, with disastrous results. And it's very dangerous to make assumptions. And you'll hear we've tried to challenge assumptions about quality. Interesting story going back to my earlier profession to illustrate the danger of assumptions. Visualize a little country school. Break time, in the corner, a little boy sitting writing. As an inspector there for the day, looking at creative writing, goes over to a little boy who was by himself, wonders what on earth he's doing. He's obviously a little farmer's lad, a bit scruffy. Looks over his shoulder and he sees, yesterday, yesterday, yesterday. Sorrow, sorrow, sorrow. Today, today, today. Hope, hope, hope. Tomorrow, tomorrow, tomorrow. Happiness, happiness, happiness. Well, he's taken aback. tapped the little boy on the shoulder, said, "Young man, lovely piece of work. What a lovely poem." The boy looks up and he says, "No, it's not a poem, sir, it's some spelling corrections." Assumptions can be dangerous. So here we are to challenge them and see a way forward by listening to Sam and to Bill, who's been leading on the National Workforce Development Group, and Sam and I have got some members of it. So, who's to speak first?
I'm speaking first.
Here comes Bill.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Bill. I had a bit of a band yesterday. I'm not taking a show of all tell jokes. Welcome, everybody. We want this to be interactive, please. So I'm just going to spend a short amount of time setting context, and then really want to kind of open it up, and hopefully we'll have, you know, a good discussion and some diverse sort of opinions and perspectives to sort of challenge assumptions, as Bill's just been saying. Sam will be helping to facilitate that. On the table, just as a kind of a straw poll on this, there are three papers, produced by Personal last year. How many people would have already seen those or read them before today? So about 40%. That's pretty good. That's better than I was anticipating. Well, that's good. Well, I want to do a very brief overview of their genesis and their content, and then we're going to use those as a bit of a springboard in terms of discussion then for the rest of the session. And just to set this in, if you go to the first slide, please, Sam. The Market Development Forum, which I chair, is a work stream of Think Local, Act Personal. It actually came out of the previous initiative around putting people first. And the idea behind it was in the and you thinking around personalisation, what are the implications for market shaping, market development, commissioning, provision, and how we consult and understand what it is that individuals want, and how we put all that together, and what we learn from that. And so we as part of the partnership that Things of Black Personal created, a subgroup that was representative of that diverse partnership came together to look at care markets, essentially, in inverted commas, really. But really what we were looking at was this relationship between this is how I'd like to be supported, with a provider saying, okay, then this is what it means for us, and then the commissioner coming in thinking, well, okay, that's what it means from my perspective, and putting the three perspectives together. And we produced a number of key reports. If we go on to the next, we've got a model for market facilitation. There's some work currently going on across the country, actually, which the department perhaps has been funding around creating market position statements, and the Institute of Public Care have been supporting where councils want it, their ability to do that, sprung out of this work here around market facilitation we did in 2 years ago. The other thing we created, there's been a number of things, but these are the highlights. The other thing we created was something called a protocol for better market relations, because the co-production team that were working within the Market Development Forum said, yes, we attend meetings, but we don't really influence what's going on. And part of it is just the way the meetings are run, the way professionals behave, and they're busy, they do things, they're not being impolite or unkind, but it's just we don't feel very included, and therefore they're not getting the best out of us. And so what we were saying, and providers were saying the same thing in terms of antagonistic relationships, the rest of it, we said, well, actually, it's in everybody's interests to get this right. And so we actually created a protocol about what actually good co-production looks like and what good market sort of consultation looks like, and for everybody to sign up to that. And that kind of flowed on to the bit that we're going to come on to now. Because when the white paper was, which came out, it had an annex paper which was about quality. And it came out at the same time, essentially, it was a bit of an overlap with the Think Local, Act Personal initiative called Making It Real, How many people have heard of making it real in order to draw one?
Oh, that's a much better response. That's excellent.
And they didn't cross-reference, unfortunately, although they actually came at it from slightly different angles. They were trying to achieve similar things in terms of being more outcome-focused and defining quality as an outcome rather than a process. And so having realised that the Department of Health approached the thing called that first and said, actually, what would be really useful is to use your partnership links to sort of try and pull this together for us. And the result of that work, we issued these three papers. So we go on to the next slide. Now the first paper, The first one is really defining the what. What is quality? The second one is defining the kind of the how, is it's kind of a quality assurance, what does it look like in terms of what we expect to see in quality. And the third one, who is the interesting one, which comes from the protocol, is who's responsible for what within quality. And that's kind of where we'll build on in a moment. But the first one just was very, very top line, and it very much defined quality as from the perspective of the individual. So it's very individualistic. What is quality? For me, it's different from somebody else. You know, they're easy words to say. It's a bit like respect, dignity. You know, what are respectful behaviours for me? It'll be different respectful behaviours for somebody else. And actually, to find out, it's probably best to ask somebody. And that way you probably will get it right, not just to make the assumptions as Bill was saying before. So it was very much from the perspective of, it was very individual. But there were things, there were core principles. The three principles were, just to summarise for you. The first one was that the person is at the centre of their support. So it was a reinforcement, restatement of a whole person-centred approaches, which is ultimately sprung personalisation. It also picked up the point I've just made, it's very much about outcomes, it's not about process. So it's about the outcomes that are being achieved. So the individual at the centre, the outcomes are achieved. And then, actually another point that Bill's just raised, what it also then went on to say, which I think was quite new, was the relationship between the person who is using the service and the people who deliver it is based on dignity and respect. So there was an interaction element to it, that actually quality doesn't sit on itself. What usually happens is that there's an interactive process, and what does that interactive process feel like? So those three elements were seen as core. We then went on, and we actually did some surveying of quality standards and across the country, and what the councils are using, and what we're using. Of course, there are the compliance standards from CQC, etc. And we found there was a huge variation, and quite a confusing picture. And so we certainly didn't think it was for us to recommend one or the other or whatever, or do any sort of in-depth analysis of it. What we decided to do instead was to strip them back, as it were, to what is in common. What would you expect to see from any sort of quality system? And we then said, well, okay, within a quality assurance system, you would expect to see these following principles. And just to run through them very briefly for you. The first one was that they should be based on the features generally agreed as constituting high quality. So the circular argument there, but as defined by the persons at the centre, their relationships are good, and their outcome focus. So they should be based on that principle of understanding what quality is all about, however they define it. The other fundamental point was that it should ensure that the views of people receiving the care and support and indeed their families and carers as appropriate, are heard in all the quality assessments. So it had to have a co-production element to it. There was no point when a quality system was disconnected from the people who were at the centre of the whole thing. It also includes an assessment of the workforce, the leadership in particular, local leadership, skill development, and again, going back to this thing, the behaviours, the experience, what is it that people are experienced by. The thing that Bill was saying earlier around the Francis Inquiry, there were a number of things that came out of that. But what was quite clear, one of the issues that was coming out there, was actually the experience that people were having was poor. The behaviours were poor. And so that's actually an important part of actually well-being and feeling that you're getting a good service. Also was very much around starting with the individual, but also actually considering the individual within the wider context. So yes, it's an individualised process, but actually none of us are islands. It needs to be seen in the context of the wider environment that we all live within and our circles of support, wherever else it might be. And then to which I think is another important general principle. It should be transparent. Whatever we do, even if we're making decisions that might be unpopular, they should be transparent decisions. I've just been appointed onto the board of NICE, and one of the things that NICE, I think, has managed to do over recent years is been able to make incredibly complex decisions, which are quite controversial, but are seen to be fair, because they are totally transparent, and they are totally open to anybody to examine what they did. There will be people who are not happy with the decision, but they can't complain by the process they got to the end point. Somebody had to make the decision. And so people will accept that. Quality was never about, you know, just anything I want, I can have. It was about actually having some transparency in the system. If you remember the Winterbourne View scandal and disgrace, one of the issues there was within the culture of that service. It was a closed culture. Parents weren't allowed to visit. CQC could only visit with somebody watching everywhere they went. It was on psychopathal sort of therapeutic grounds that they came up with these rules. It was a totally locked down, closed environment. So, you know, it was never going to be open to for scrutiny and created all sorts of issues because of it. And then so finally, including assessment of the impact of commissioning on quality. We felt that actually this is part of the triangle. So, you know, there was, how does one procure and commission, again, with a view to outcomes rather than, again, process? And within that, there was a need to represent value for money and be proportionate to the services being assured. That was very much the provider was saying that. Because part of the problem was that the complexity of quality assurance can be really quite considerable. When you start digging down and start layering it in terms of health and safety assessments, in terms of workforce assessments, in terms of, you know, all sorts of different things that might come together with an assessment. In actual fact, and all you're doing is running a community scheme for, you know, people to learn how to do whatever, it can be completely disproportionate to what you're trying to achieve. Which is very different from if you're running a Craig Moore type of care service. So there was something about proportionality in terms of what's good enough for the end user and what that would mean. So there were a number of elements in that. So there's a bit more detail in the plan, but I felt that they were a useful starting point. And I know some organisations have actually translated those for individuals and for carers, where, you know, when they're using their personal budgets or they're going through some form of selection process for a provider. Of course, they're met with providers saying all the same things, because we will, won't we? And so what we then said, well, okay, here's some questions that might get under the skin a little bit more. Here's some other kind of more challenging questions around how they go about doing things. And they're based around some of what you would expect to see. What does this mean for me? And how would that translate to my experience and your service, whatever else it might be? And they have that sort of broken out, so which you can still use this top level type of principle, but then dig down in terms of, well, what might that mean to me, and how will I experience that? And how genuine are you transparent, for instance? And what does it mean? And the final one, which is who is responsible for quality? And we have this great drawing here, which unfortunately this has not been focused very well. It's just mirrored. It's not focused. It's a dishwasher tablet. And you'll see in the documents, but I like it actually, because it looks at the sort of five key areas of responsibility. You've got individuals in the centre, you've got a range of providers here. You've got regulators and what's known as standard setters. So organisations like NICE, Sky, etc. Skills for Care. You then have got councils, clinical commission groups here. And then you've got here the local community, the environment, the wider context. And all of these have an impact upon how this person might feel about the quality of their service. Now, okay, three of those segments, people are paid to get it right. This bit is largely voluntary, and this bit certainly is voluntary, but these three bits are paid to get it right. So clearly the document says a little bit more about those who have been paid to get this right, as opposed to those who could have an enabling process and be helping themselves more. and that might be something that might be brought up in the conversation a bit later. But just to give you some examples. For people in the sensitive, people using their own services, we felt that there actually was a reasonable thing to have expectation that actually people would inform themselves about their choices as best as they can. And one of the ways of doing that is talk to others, perhaps. And I know Twitter is a great enabler in this sphere. One of the things that will happen within Twitter is a parent will say, you know, I've had this experience for this council or that provider or whatever else it might be, and I'd like to tell everyone else about it. And it might be a good or a bad experience. All the parents when it came to that, that's actually very, very powerful informing process, isn't it, in terms of influencing people's decision making. We've also got, I suppose, a responsibility to, although it's difficult, to encourage responsibility to speak up, to say, actually, I'm not happy, one of the challenges we had when we were doing this was a way to improve quality was to reduce expectations. Which is not quite the point. We want to raise expectations that will put upward pressure on the system that actually our aspirations are higher. How do you do that? Well, one of the things is feeling more and more encouraged to speak up and say, I want something better, I want something different. I want to join together with other people to say we want something better and different. And so that's very much an important part of the responsibility of families and carers to keep at that as much as they're able to do. Within the commissioning side of things, we were very keen to see the market position statements as are being produced at the moment, but also we were very keen to continue the promotion towards self-directed means of support. One of the central themes of Think Local Act Personal is personalisation, and we still want to maximise as best as possible the sense that people are able to kind of self-direct their own support, fund their own support, and have as much control over it as possible, and they keep challenging the system, including providers and commissioners around that. And we feel this is a fundamental driver of quality. So I'll leave it there and take any sort of questions in terms of just what I've just been saying, in terms of any sort of clarity, before we maybe open it up then for a bit more discussion. So is there anything? I've just run a very quick whistle stop to open those three documents. Definitely recommend you have a look at them and read them in detail. They're not very long. They're on the train the way home, I've read them. So any immediate questions or thoughts from the audience? Any challenges? Mm-hmm. Who's got a microphone?
Hi, Joan Huff here. I've got a couple of roles, but I'm a member of the National Co-Production Advisory Group for Think Local Act Personal, so I have been a little bit involved in some of this, and the Market Development Forum was a really interesting strand of Think Local Act Personal's work. I just wondered, do you think it is a responsibility of providers to actually empower their residents, the people who use their services, to speak up? As well, is that something that they really ought to be encouraging actively?
Yeah, I mean, I should have declared right at the outset, I am a provider, I'm part of the TLAP group as a representative of providers. The answer is absolutely yes. I mean, within my own organisation, one of the commitments that we have for people is to enable people to speak up, and that means to speak up, you know, things that are not happy about us. You know, as opposed to, you know, just the world in general, which, you know, which becomes a more of a hazy area, where as a provider, you know, how independent are you when you're advocating on behalf of somebody else against, for instance, you know, their assessment or settlement or whatever it might be, when it's in your interest also. And so I think that is a more hazy area, and there are other ways of achieving that sort of advocacy and better ways of doing it. But in terms of people, I think every organisation makes better decisions if actually they increase their accountability to the people that they're supporting or serving in some way. There's no doubt about that. The better you inform jobs, so, you know, and so the more you encourage that. And of course, you know, we are talking about supporting the most disadvantaged people within society. People who actually struggle to have a voice, and so you actually have to, you know, you have to do that with a lot of integrity. You know, you have to encourage it, and I've from a background of supporting people with learning disabilities, and all the evidence shows you actually people have to learn how to speak up for themselves. It's just not something that will come naturally, particularly, you know, when you think of people who, in an older generation, have lived through long-stay hospitals, where compliance was the name of the day, and so you didn't rock the system. And so actually to turn around and sort of feel that you can, you know, be empowered to say you're not happy or to self-direct is actually quite a big step for somebody, and then people need help and learning around that.
Yeah, I'd agree with you there, Bill, that I'm still aware of people who aren't aware they have a choice. Mm-hmm. You know, or they're not sure what choice actually is. Is it what someone's telling them is their choice, or do they have something outside of that they might be able to choose as well? So,
but one of the questions, going back to the questions you should ask as a carer, or indeed an individual, is exactly that, actually. I mean, what steps do you take to enable people to speak?
I think for some people, both in health and social care, I've found there's a fear set in mental health. If you question or challenge, the service you get will be penalised.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. Has that been your experience?
Yes. Yeah. That's a fact.
Do you want to say something?
No, I just want to personally know myself. Do you actually go out without a suit? Do you visit service users? As you're like not on the cover, but just go out and find out what it's actually like?
Yeah, I do.
Without telling your staff, you go in or send you an email, whatever. Just go out yourself.
Yeah.
Undercover. Yeah. See what it's like.
Well, I don't get away with being undercover, unfortunately, because everybody knows me. But that's because I do get out and about. But no, I work a shift, and I, you know, I will tend to wear a suit. Although I was the scruffiest, I was a care support worker. I was how I started. I was the scruffiest care support worker you could imagine. I wear a suit these days as a mark of respect. Mm. I don't see it as a kind of a power dressing thing. I think it's a kind of, you know, actually. I am who I am in terms of my job role, and people need to know that because I've got accountability around that. I can't actually pretend that I've never got that accountability. I've always got that accountability. And so therefore, if people are unhappy, they should tell me. But I think it's really important to get perspective. And I mean, every summer, I think most reputable senior managers should be doing this, actually, would be spending time in and around services. And actually, my own belief is if you've got the right sort of culture in an organisation, you should be able to do that without actually making a lot of impact. I mean, you know, that would be naive of me to say that people aren't trying to put themselves forward in the best light when the boss is coming in to visit. But you can see through the kind of the phoniness and what is actually just people wanting to be proud of their work, actually, and talking about what they're doing. Ashling wants to say something.
Yeah, no, I mean, just responding as I'm also a provider of Ashling Certitude, we provide support for people with learning disabilities and mental health needs, and I think there absolutely is a key role in providers supporting people to speak up. But I think in some ways our bigger role, or perhaps the role that I think chief executives in particular have, is how we inspire staff across the organisation to understand the role they have in driving up quality. And I think, you know, that is about the kind of culture you're trying to create and the kind of resources that you want to develop in your staff to be the advocates and to walk alongside people and to really be inspiring the people they're supporting to be demanding the highest possible service that they're looking for. I mean, I think one of the quotes in some of the papers, this one, I just think, right, you can never know if you're satisfied unless you have expectations of what good looks like. Mm-hmm. And that was from somebody using services. And I think there's a big role for us, I think, across TLAP and interested partners to really be using these documents and others to really help our staff, our support staff, working with the most vulnerable people to really make the highest demand of them and of the organisations and of the community. And the other comment I kind of wanted to make was I had a recent interesting conversation with a commissioner that will absolutely remain nameless, who would describe the support that we provide as being, in her words, 5-star, but that she can't afford 5-star. And actually, she would rather pay for 3-star from us. So more, the people who are currently getting 1-star would have some hope of getting 2 or 3-star. Then carry on funding Firestart. Now, there's a whole variety of responses to that, but I suppose one of them for me is, how do we make better use of the middle group in your dishwasher tablet and in the bottom left in local communities? And actually, we do have to find other people who are helping us in unpaid capacities to actually monitor the quality of what we're doing. And yeah, some of the initiatives that I've seen around kind of cocktails and care homes, bringing a local community into to care homes, sharing drinks, getting the local neighbours to think they have a role also in supporting a local care home, are some of the things that I think can make a real positive, broader difference to people's life and still allow us to perhaps deliver. Yeah, I'm clinging hard to 5-star, I can tell you, but yeah, that will allow us to still do that with less money.
Just going back a little bit to the nervousness about speaking, about being encouraged to speak up. There's a responsibility on the care provider, whatever, also to listen. One of the beliefs I have for talking about the Francis report is that patients did speak up, but they weren't listened to. Exactly. They were not listened to. There's an art to responding to people who speak up. There's a quote here I shall show you. There are people who, instead of listening to what is being said to them, are already listening to what they are going to say. And that's often the case when people speak up. Are you really listening, or are you being patronising, paternalistic, condescending? What are you doing? Be honest about quality of listening.
Anyone else want to say something?
Just really briefly, I think it's a role somewhere.
Introduce yourself.
My name's Louise. I feel like it's from a big coming out session. I'm a couple of things, but I'm also a trustee of a provider organisation, and that's the bit that I'm making this comment in. I just think there is something in there about trustees. I take your point about, do you visit, do you go, do you see, do you do, are you around? And I don't think it is just about the paid staff and about the chief exec taking the suit off to do that. I put the challenge out to the trustees and ask how many really know what that organisation is doing and getting on with, or do they come and sit at meetings and ratify direction and payments? Because there is a whole section of people there, the trustees, for many, many reasons. And I would wonder, in this room, I said to you all, how engaged the trustees that you have in terms of actually knowing what a shift looks like, what goes on, no matter what the setting, where are they in this?
Can I just make a comment on the suit? When I mentioned the suit, that you've got a lovely suit on. It's got nothing to do with it. My point was... My point was, I just wanted, whoever you spoke to, not to know who you was.
Yeah.
That's my point was, because sometimes it's nice when people actually listen to you and they don't know who you are.
Yeah.
And then you introduce yourself afterwards and then, oh, that's nice, you know.
Yeah. No, I agree. Just personally, I couldn't do it because I've been in the organisation so long, everybody knows me. And my face, literally, is on the complaints because it's an excessive complaint. And so when I visit a service, I'm the guy you need to complain to. So, you know, it's quite difficult to do that. But I take your point. But having said that, I still feel if you're running organisation with good culture, I mean, you know, people, there's, you know, good staff are quite advocating, actually. There is something about care and support staff which, you know, and we've done a lot of personality surveying around this as an organisation, and one of the things that comes out very strongly is a tendency not to put yourself forward, so they themselves can put themselves at a disadvantage, which is an issue for them as a workforce. But actually, they're very strong on behalf of other people in matters of principles. And so, you know, what I find more typically is that on a matter of principle, nobody's scared to tackle you. People will speak up. They might be shy and inhibited about saying, you know, I'd like more money, but they're far less shy and inhibited about saying, what I'm seeing for Mary's not right, we need to do something about it. My experience.
experience. So even even you know, even if you are going in with status, mm-hmm. I still find that people will willing to speak up, which is good. You should be encouraged, you know.
Okay,
sorry.
Secret.
No, I don't personally, but I think it's a good idea, and other people do. They do that, actually. Yeah. Yeah.
Tim Gollings, work for Yorkshire Number ADAS. One of your principles is start with the individual, because the group level might mask some poor quality provision at local and individual level. But to what extent do we really value the quality when councils block contracts massive amounts of domiciliary care?
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I suppose I could throw that question out for you. I mean, that's quite an interesting discussion, isn't it? The price versus quality. I mean, most councils, and you know, I'm sure Sarah will say, this better than I can. Most councils will say there's not a straight line between how much you pay and the quality. And so, you know, there is therefore a more complicated connection. But intuitively, there has to be a bottom line somewhere below which you can't go and what the implications of that would be. And I think that's more of a difficult one. But I think it's a legitimate debating point. And it picks up Aisling's point as well. One of the problems I think all of us professionals have got, and I'm speaking here as a professional representing, you know, all of us really, is that our solutions tend to be we need more of us. And therefore we do tend to create a dependency on us, whatever part we come from. But actually, I think some of the challenge of this segment here is, can you enable alternatives? And of course that usually can get you into that's just cheap care, volunteering care instead of paid staff and the rest of it. I'm not meaning to go into that territory. I'm talking about genuinely, how much are we re-enabling people to kind of, say, get on with their own life, rather than increasing dependency on professionals, which is what we're very good at doing. Do you want to say
something? Yeah, Sarah, pick up from Hertfordshire. We've done some work in Hertfordshire looking at, is there a correlation between the price we pay and the quality we get in terms of home care, and particularly around retention of staff, because that's key to quality, and actually there isn't. You know, I'm not saying there's no correlation anywhere, because otherwise I'll be shot and have been before. But what we've found genuinely is that it isn't the people we pay the most that deliver the highest quality care and retain their staff the best. And actually, it isn't the people we pay the most who pay their workforce the most. There isn't a direct correlation. However, it is absolutely true that there is a crisis in the funding of care. And in particular, that is affecting that care in people's own homes and that home care market, because the demand is really rising. There's people, we want to help people stay at home. And whether they buy it themselves with direct payment, or whether it's a personal budget, or however it's done, it's really hard to recruit staff, it's really hard to retain staff, and it's really hard to have enough money to buy enough care. And you know, we shouldn't get away from that message. There is a point below which you can't go. Councils should be using models to make sure that they're not asking things to be done that it's impossible to do for what they want to pay, so you shouldn't cap your price, they're ridiculous. There's nothing wrong with capping the price if you cap it at a level which within which it's possible to deliver care. There's lots of things that aren't wrong per se, but they're badly used. And I think you know, we should all be looking at that model from the provider perspective. I've said this before and I'll say it again, is that providers should not bid for contracts at prices they know they cannot deliver the spec for. Now, I know some providers would say that you have to all be out of business, but what I say is you'll be out of business anyway if you can't deliver the spec. We'll have a load of people who are badly supported along the way and are damaged along the way. So, there is a big underlying fundamental funding issue. But I do think this thing about getting the right people in the right place, so it's not about cheap and cheerful, but we've got some home care providers in Hertfordshire who have set up their own sort of voluntary arm. And so they do the basic care, but they also have other things to offer people. So we have people who are users of home care have been taken flying by the voluntary arm of the agency that's delivering the care. And we have a meals service, which is able to do pop-in, because they've got an infrastructure right across this social enterprise. Infrastructure, vehicles, people, volunteers and paid workers. And they can do pop-ins, not care, but they can check you're all right. And so there is a mix of things you can use to make best use of the money, and it isn't all about just continually pushing that home care price down.
I'd just like to add a slight comment to that in a cautionary way, because I have interviewed vast numbers of domiciliary care workers and receive people who receive the care, and some of the workers don't get mileage between, they don't get, there's no flexibility, so if somebody is off sick, they might send somebody inappropriate to deliver personal care, depending on your ethnicity, and it seems to be that most of those providers do drive down, you know, they're all on minimum wage, and the ones who are good do it because they have a true vocation, and I would ask local authorities to remember that, you know, that that is being driven down by the suppliers often, not always, but often, and I think it's to the detriment of the service because it, it can be fantastic.
Well, we've got less time than I thought we might, but that's fantastic because everyone's really got involved in this discussion anyway, and that was absolutely the point. And thanks to Bill for running through that. I'm sure you'll agree we're very lucky to have him in a chairing role with the National Market Development Forum. The piece of work, as he said, it was about engaging the sector in further developing a document that was published alongside the white paper that was called Bringing Clarity to Quality. And I think everyone I've spoken to suggested that it didn't bring clarity to quality. So we hope the work that TLAP has done thus far at least takes us a bit further in the direction of bringing that clarity, and Bill and Des in particular have been sort of instrumental in driving that work for us. We thought what we would do was to try and kind of replicate around tables that dishwasher tablet as unfortunately, to get into a bit of a discussion on your tables about what you see as your role in relation to assuring quality. Because the key point here is that, yes, there are paid parties here that must take a specific role, but it is a wider community-based responsibility. We've got limited time in which to do that now, so I'm not entirely sure that that's going to work. So the other question we're going to have for you that would be really helpful for you to give us a steer on, that perhaps we can helpfully use the last 10 minutes for, is that we are, as I touched on in my slides this morning, taking forward work on quality. And there are two things that we're doing. I mentioned that we have a regional programme underway this year. We are encouraging the ADAS regions that are engaging with us in that to do work as part of that regional TLAP-sponsored programme to look at how they can adopt and use this quality framework that we've been talking about, and to do so in a way that gets precisely the folk we have with us here in the room together to hear from all those different perspectives. So that's one of the things we're doing, is saying, well, if this is any use, and people are telling us it is, and it's one of the documents, especially the WHO document, that's been the most downloaded from TLAP's website, I think, in the calendar year, and then what can you do locally and regionally to pick this up and use it and apply it? So that's one of the things we're doing. The other bit we're doing, which I touched on, was that we're establishing a national quality forum. I said bringing clarity to quality was the intention here. In the national space, it is a very congested and quite confusing space around quality. There's a national quality board run through the Department of Health. There's a nursing and care quality forum. There's the role that NICE play, and there's the role that Andrew will be taking up in, for the regulator. There are improvement agencies. Every one of those has some sort of role in relation to quality nationally. And we felt that there was a space, and we've been encouraged by our funders and partners to take up that space to provide some overall leadership, shape and coordination to what's happening nationally around quality. One of the things we are expecting will be pushed our way as a result of taking on that kind of responsibility is, and especially given Andrea's role within TLAP, which will continue, helping to provide a sounding board with all of the people within TLAP represented on it. So people using services, the provider side, the commissioning side, the improvement agencies, for the CQC and their development of aggregate quality ratings for providers, which is a part of Andrea's big tasks when she gets into post. There are other things we may well be asked to do as well. So I suppose the open question to you would be to just hear back any views that there are or steers you'd like to give us on what you think a national TLAP quality forum could helpfully do in its first 12 months that would have a real impact both nationally and within your own kind of organisations and localities on the work that you do. So it's really an open question. I hope I've phrased that reasonably well. We're setting up this piece of work. We want to build on what we've done already. We need to hear from everybody about how valuable or useful that might be. And is there anything specific you think we should be honing in on?
Hello, I'm Vicky Gailey from Live White. One of my big issues around quality and market is the fact that our customers and our commissioners, and how do we support them as commissioners to know, A, that they're getting the quality that they should be getting, and that they know where to go to check that quality out. You know, we as commissioners are used to doing that, and we've got all these things in place, you know. So how do we support, without being paternalistic, those individual commissioners to get it right, and including things like, you know, contracts, and, you know, they're all signing contracts with providers and they've never done it before, and, you know, we have to trust in a way that providers are trustworthy and they're going to do what they're doing, and I'm sure the majority of them are, but it's kind of that small print. How do we support people to get that right, really?
Okay, I'm not sure we're going to have the answers to this, but that's a really good steer, but we can take that away and see if there's anything we can do on that front. Unless anyone obviously in the room has something that will help with that particular point.
Just to add to that, and I think it builds on the point actually, there's something about influence, isn't there? There's commissioners influencing providers through the contracts that have been signed. Increasingly, as we see direct payments taking up, we're going to need to see commissioners acting in a way that influences providers who aren't in their contract. So it's part of that, how do we provide quality assurance, is about how do we actually ensure that we influence the whole of the provider market.
Without taking over.
Yeah, right.
Okay, I'm going to capture these points. So any other points? I think we're into our last 5 minutes, and we're going to need to move back into the main room very shortly. But any other final points people would like to make, either on the discussion that we've had, or on what we might do with this quality forum, Ashley?
I'm not sure it's for this one, it might be actually one of the other workshops, but I think there's something around the quality of co-production. I think it's an increasing concern that it's a word and process that's been used in a variety of contexts that don't, I think, fit with what TLAP would define as co-production. So I think there's something about how we do that in a much more simpler and more transparent way for people using services, but also for providers and commissioners.
Sure.
Maybe it's as much to know when it is and what it isn't as well.
I think we published something in conjunction with the Social Care Institute of Excellence called our Top 10 Tips for Co-Production recently. But I think a next step from that may well be precisely what I'm describing, and perhaps this could be a good place to do it. Any final thoughts from you?
Sorry, me again. One of my big issues, and I was talking about it to colleagues over lunch, is around PAs and how do we support the PA market to be quality. You know, there's a huge black hole in terms of CQC, there's a huge kind of uncertainty around employment and self-employment. There's a massive problem that I've uncovered around DBS checks, that they can't be DBS checked, and the individual employee is not legally entitled to ask for a DBS check. How do we support individual employers and PAs to provide quality services? That's outside of the training that we should be trying to provide for both parties. And I'm not advocating at all that we should be, every PA should be CQC registered. I'm not advocating that everybody should be DBS checked, but it should be easy as a customer to be able to achieve those things and get that quality assurance through that market as well.
Thank you.
Can I just ask you, do you still do council-led training for PAs and for individual employers?
We're starting to build a programme around that. We did do for a little while and then it kind of petered out, and now we're kind of recognising that we need to do.
Hearing. It's very variable.
Yeah, it's for staff as well, you know, the kind of, we did the personalisation, it was here, now it's embedded, and I was suddenly thinking, oh, we might need to do a bit more training on that. So yeah.
Okay, we've had some hands shooting up. We've got virtually no time. So there's three hands I've seen, and then we'll have to wrap this up. But firstly, Janet, then to the back. I think Sarah wants to make a point as well.
I'm a bit concerned because people are living independently in their own home, and their carers, what they've employed through social services, are leaving because of lack of money, and they're also employing other carers from different parts of the country and putting them into accommodation to do their care. And it shouldn't be like that because it should be saving money, not paying more money.
I'll just probably just real couple off that need to think about. One, I think it's possibly a quality issue, but it's a transition from children's service to adult services, that's a significant jump for people, as well as a shift from social care to healthcare, particularly continuing healthcare, the level of quality, depends which way you come from, whether quality goes up or down, but it certainly is a point of transition that needs to be considered.
The thing about POs and what we can do, I think training can be offered, and I think son of whatever, I can't remember what they're called now, but son of CRV checks can be offered by councils as well. One of the things that happens in Hertfordshire is the Providers Association has taken some responsibility for POs, and they've apprenticed POs through the Provider Association, which gives people a place to learn and a place to kind of become a PA rather than just being one day a citizen and the next minute a PA. So I think it's an option.
Okay, I'm going to have to call time for this. It feels like something that we could talk about all afternoon, which gives me at least some encouragement that we're doing the right thing. So,
and just very quickly to say a big thank you to Sam and to Bill, and particularly to this audience. You've been very responsive and productive, quite sensible, really. So thank you ever so much for coming.